good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the our webinar today on Phragmites control for homeowners and land stewards. My name is Heather Braun, and I'm the Habitat Restoration Project Manager at the Great Lakes Commission, and I'll be moderating the webinar today. Before we begin, I wanted to go over some logistics. We have quite a few people who have registered for the webinar today, so our participants have been muted to avoid background noise. Because you're in listen-only mode, you don't need to phone in. You can just listen on your computer. Please ask questions at any time in the webinar through the question and answer panel on the right side of your screen. You're welcome to ask, and we will try to answer your questions as best we can through the webinar, throughout the webinar, and we'll also have a question period at the end for you. The webinar is being recorded and will be posted to the Great Lakes Phragmites Collaborative website. This webinar is part of a series developed through the Great Lakes Phragmites Collaborative, which is a partnership to improve communication and collaboration and lead to more coordinated, efficient, and strategic approaches to Phragmites management, restoration, and research across the Great Lakes Basin. In today's webinar, you will learn about practical aspects of small-scale, cost-efficient, invasive Phragmites control, including recommendations, methods, products, and equipment that are easily available to homeowners and land stewards. No helicopters, no contractors, no prescribed burning, and no grant money. Our speaker today is Bob Williams, and Bob has over 10 years of invasive Phragmites management experience and serves as a volunteer for the MSU Extension. He also founded the website phragmites.org and has presented dozens of public workshops and in-field trainings. If you are on the Great Lakes Phragmites Collaborative listserv, you may have noticed the recent three-part blog series written by Bob. If you haven't read those yet, we encourage you to do that, and they're available on the Great Lakes Phragmites Collaborative website. That series focuses on taking advantage of opportunities specific to small-scale control programs and are a great accompaniment to today's webinar. So thank you for joining us today, Bob.
Thank you, Heather.
And you may begin.
Okay. Well, I suspect those of you out there who are listening today have a wide range of knowledge of Phragmites control, and I want to try to provide the basics for those with no experience while also providing some new information for those who already have experience with Phragmites control. If you have a reasonable amount of experience, you might use this presentation to help you think about developing your own control workshop to expand your impact on the Phragmites invasive control world. I've developed this PowerPoint in my workshops over the last 8 years, and the answers to almost every question I've ever been asked are incorporated into the presentation. So we have a lot of slides. This presentation is based upon my standard homeowners workshop called Practical Phragmites Control, but I've modified it today to shorten the time spent on material that most of you probably already know. If you hear ideas for control which are new to you, I hope that you'll be encouraged to do some experimentation of your own with these different control methods and perhaps do a little bit of your own citizen science along the way. Today's webinar is specifically about small-scale control methods, which Heather mentioned, and those three topics which she mentioned are in the blog. We will touch on those very briefly during this presentation, but each one of them deserves considerable time to answer questions you might have, so the blog would be the place to find those answers. In addition, on July 10th at noon, I'm going to be discussing these three topics in a webinar presented by the Stewardship Network. You can sign up for that pretty soon at www.stewardshipnetwork.org. Today, I've got about 120 slides to go through, and I'll be moving pretty fast. Heather's going to try to break in with questions if she can get me to stop talking, but some may have to wait till the answer to the end for an answer. But if you don't get an answer, you can always email me at bob@phragmites.org. There at the bottom of your screen is my email address. And also, if we go too fast for you, there will be an archive copy of this on the Phragmites Collaborative website, along with a handout of all the slides, which you can print out. Okay, first picture is about a problem with Phragmites, that it blocks views. This is my
Fire them out on Harson's Island. You can see that I had quite a Phragmites problem, which blocked views from both the second and first floors of my barn and house. And today, this is what it looked like. It took a few years to make that happen, but it certainly is possible to control Phragmites. Most of you probably know many of the other problems with Phragmites. These are the ones that homeowners are most concerned about: fire hazards, reducing property values and tourism, limiting access for their recreation to get to their boats or to get to their beach, and it damages valuable landscaping. In large scale or agencies, which conservation agencies, they're usually concerned more about reducing the fact that it reduces native plant and animal habitat and the population and diversity, but you'll find very few homeowners who really consider that to be a concern. Other concerns of large agencies are that it dries out wetlands, fills in canals, rivers, and streams, clogs water intakes, it's a navigation hazard on roads and waterways, and it hinders search and rescue operations. Now, the fact that homeowners and large agencies like the DNR have different goals in mind or different concerns, it actually gives a different result in what they should be doing to control Phragmites. Some of the things I usually talk about for homeowners is they always want to know where it comes from, and we talk about the early shipping in the 1800s and how the Phragmites was in the ballast of the ships and got dumped over here. This is four maps. The top two are before 1910. On the left is our native Phragmites. It was everywhere. And back in 1910, it was only on the East Coast. But now, 50 years later, we see that the invasive Phragmites has reached all parts of the country. And people want to know when it became a problem. This is a picture from 1972. I would ask, usually in my workshop, does anyone recognize this picture? So I'm going to ask the people in my room here. Does anybody recognize it?
Godfather? No.
It's a little silence. But it was from The Godfather, yes. This is the famous take the cannoli and leave the gun scene, and obviously they had a Phragmites problem on Staten Island back in 72. Where does it grow? Here's a picture in downtown Detroit. Here it is. It doesn't grow just in wet areas. Here it is on the top of a 40-foot hill. One thing we do know, though, normally when it grows in drier areas, particularly on hills, it's usually from roots or being brought in with dirt, with fill dirt. This was a mound, a berm that was created intentionally to block the view of the utility site here, and you can see Phragmites grew in the soil that was brought into the site. Here's an interesting condition where a contractor walked away from this construction site for a year, and when they came back, we had basements. They had basements full of Phragmites. Now let's talk briefly about small-scale versus large-scale projects. Of course, homeowners have small sites with limited resources. Conservation areas usually have large sites, but their problem is usually short-term funding. Homeowners like to do the work themselves. They want fast results, and they usually want complete removal. Conservation areas, they can hire contractors, but they do not concentrate on complete removal because they're usually responsible for providing the greatest amount of service to the environment for the number of dollars that they're presented. If they try to control the Phragmites 100% in any particular area, they would probably, for the cost of partially treating 1,000 acres, they could probably completely control Phragmites in 200 or 300 acres, and whereas with the partial control, they're probably getting a total of maybe 800 acres that are cleared versus a smaller amount but complete control. So there's different goals between conservation areas and homeowners. Homeowners aren't willing to accept partial control. They usually want to see it gone completely. It would be like hiring someone to get rid of the dandelions in your lawn, and they tell you, well, we can get rid of them 80% for you, and that would not be acceptable to a homeowner. When they have weeds, they want to see it gone. The homeowner can focus on detail. The conservation areas have to look at the bigger picture. And these different goals and all the factors above do have an effect on the results. results, and that is that homeowners on an individual site can end up with 99 to 100% control of the Phragmites, and they will have invested continued control in that project. Once they have put $100 or $150, whatever it cost them to get rid of the Phragmites, into controlling it on their property, they will continue to invest the $10 or $20 every few years to keep it away. Conservation areas generally end up with 90 to 95% control while funding is still available. And as we know, most of those three-year grants for treating Phragmites runs out, and they end up waiting another 5 years before they can get a grant again. And by the time people get back there on the ground, that 90 to 95% control may be even reduced less than that, and they end up going back to do a lot of hand wiping, which is very expensive. People want to know how it spreads. Of course, we know it spreads by rhizomes and it spreads by seeds. It is persistent. It quickly takes over an area. Here it is coming straight through some pavement that has just been laid down. Here's a parking lot I saw in 2012, and I noticed these sprigs coming up. I took some pictures. They were Phragmites, and I came back a year later, and this is what the parking lot looked like. I knew the man who had the parking lot, so I offered to treat it for him, and I'll show you later the results of that. Here's a pond on Belle Isle in Detroit. I noticed this in 2011, one little stalk of Phragmites, and I went back this year, and this is what it looks like. Luckily, now the DNR has taken over Belle Isle, there is a very concerted effort to control the Phragmites, so I hope in the next couple of years this will all be gone. What can we do to control Phragmites? Basically, the standard things that you do on any invasive control project, you'd have prevention, early detection, and rapid response. People want to know if they can dig it out, and most of you probably know that tilling, digging, or pulling it will only help it spread. However, there is one exception to that that people don't think about, and that is here's an area where the rhizomes, which are on the surface called stolons, are spreading right across the surface of this wet area, and you can go over and pull those right up, and everywhere that there's a stalk, about every 6 inches, starting to grow, there's usually a little root system growing down into that muck. And if you're careful, you can go along and pull those off the surface and have a major effect on stopping that from becoming a large infestation. Can you cut it or burn it? Now, cutting or burning alone usually encourages growth. And I think in some ways that might be a misunderstanding, actually, because in most cases, the growth is about the same if you cut it as it would be if you didn't cut it, but most of the time it looks like it has grown very strong because, for instance, here in the background, we have the old Phragmites, the new Phragmites coming up in between, and then in the front here, an area that was burned, the Phragmites looks very strong and healthy, but it's really not much different than the Phragmites in the background. Cutting every 2 weeks or so for years in a row may set back a small standalone patch. And goats and sheep have been used to graze infested areas with Phragmites, and they will eat it. One of the problems is that goats and sheep will cost about five times as much to rent to keep your Phragmites chewed off as it is to hire someone to cut the Phragmites for you. Goats and sheep, if you want some publicity in your area on your Phragmites control project, get some goats and sheep. The media just eat it up. They love to have a story of using goats and sheep to get rid of invasive plants. Now, one exception about not cutting it is if you can cut it below the water line, you can have an effect on it. You can almost drown the plant if you can cut it below the water line and keep it cut below the water line. Now, let me go back one here. This is my property line on Harson's Island. This is my neighbor's property, and this is mine. I was out there the winter before this photo, and I scraped off all the Phragmites, even with the ice line, where the water is now. You can see that this picture taken in July, my neighbor's green Phragmite coming up in between their old dead Phragmites has grown to about 8 feet, and mine is just starting to break the water line here. Now, this is the same picture about a month later. As soon as it gets above the water line, it takes off because it's getting the oxygen it needs. You can see mine is still shorter than my neighbor's Phragmite, and that'll make it easier for access when I go in there to spray. It'd be easier to spray this. In fact, I think I've got some pictures coming up with that. So what does control Phragmites? People have talked about using landscape fabric. Problem with that is you have to cover the landscape fabric with good soil that you bring in to make the area usable. Cornell University, we know, is working on biological controls, and they will probably still be working on those for a few years. So the answer to the question, the big question, flooding, cutting and burning in combination with a multi-year application of herbicide can control Phragmites. And the best control without using herbicides, because some people do not like using herbicides, is achieved by drowning the plant by repeated cutting of the stems below the waterline. If you're going to do that, it's best to cut them after the Phragmites reaches about 4 feet tall or more above the waterline, and cut the stems as low as possible below the waterline so that it'll take it longer to reach the surface to begin to get oxygen. The best Phragmites control without flooding or cutting below the waterline is achieved with a multi-year plan of cutting and or burning in combination with herbicide and surfactant applied mid-August through September. The exact timing of that will depend on where you're located. This is the recommendation for basically the southern Great Lakes. If you're up north, you might have to start a little bit later. You might have to end a little bit sooner, depending upon the weather conditions. How do you get the herbicide into the plant? You can use foliar spray, cut and dab, glove of death, which is something you're probably familiar with from the Nature Conservancy. They invented that. And the last one, wipe it. That's an invention of mine because I didn't like using the glove of death. I take barbecue tongs and add some plastic tubing to make them extended, add some felt pads on the end, and I spray the herbicide right on the felt pads and then wipe it on the plant like that. That's particularly used in an area where there's valuable landscaping around the Phragmites. Why cut or burn along with the herbicide? There's a few different reasons. It stresses the plant. It allows soil exposure and blackening to encourage the native seed bank germination in case you're gonna burn it. It allows the chemicals to reach the live plant surfaces easier, and it allows better human access. So there's my 15-foot tall Phragmites in winter before I cut it. And picture on the left. Don't waste chemicals spraying this. This, about half of your chemical, will end up on the brown, dead material from previous years and will do nothing but add chemicals into the environment. You want as much of your chemical as possible to reach the green surface. That's why I pre-cut my Phragmites in the winter before so that I'm spraying this sort of situation. This is not pre-cut early on when I was doing it, and you can see that the dead material was still in the way and much taller than the area that I did pre-cut. So it made it easier for access, easier to spray. When's the best time to cut or burn? November to May. Not within 2 weeks following the herbicide treatment, because you want to give the herbicide plenty of time to reach the roots. And the reason we're spraying it in the fall, by the way, is that that's when the plant is getting ready for winter. It's absorbing and returning as many of its resources to the root system as it can to get ready for the winter. And it does take a while because the roots might be as deep as 6 or 8 feet in the ground. It takes a while for these chemicals to get down where they belong. And then after they reach the roots, it will begin to affect the part of the plant above the ground. If you're cutting with riding equipment, the best time to cut to avoid soil disturbance is when the ground is frozen. In late January around here in southern Michigan, usually the third week in January, which is about the time of the Stewardship Network Conference, the weather sometimes is perfect for cutting with riding equipment because the ground has been frozen for a few weeks and we might get a warm day where it's 50 degrees out, and I get out on my tractor and get lots of work done in that great weather. My biggest mistake in 10 years of Phragmites control was not pre-cutting it before the first season of treatment. And that's one of the topics of the blogs that are on the website. And to learn the details of that, I recommend you read that blog if you have time. Cutting recommendations, it should never be lower than 4 inches from the ground or water. Minimum of 6 inches where native plants are present, and even taller, maybe up to 12 inches if you have taller native plants. Of course, most of our heavy Phragmites infestations, there's very few native plants in amongst the Phragmites anyways. Here's some field notes. I'm not going to read them. This is if you're going to be riding a tractor, some just suggestions for keeping your tractor operating properly. And what do you do with the cuttings? Everybody wants to know, if we cut it down, what should we do? And there's a variety of answers to that. The best thing, of course, would be to burn it. If you're going to burn it in place, I suggest you only use a professional to do that. You can burn them in place, but mow them down first with fire breaks around the outside, and the flames, instead of being 30 feet high, it might only be 6 or 7 feet high, much more manageable. You can burn them after mowing them and moving them into piles or rows, which will give you better control with fire breaks. You can roll it down with a roller and leave it in place, mow it down and leave it in place, mow it down and move it to degraded areas and trails. I've done that on my property, but if you're going to do that, check with the DEQ to assure that you're not violating any wetland laws, creating basically a fill situation. And don't move any of the cuttings through any uninfested areas. You can also mow it down and remove it from the site in bulk. That's a big project and could be expensive. You can hand cut and bag them for removal with trash. In Michigan in particular, I do know that you can put invasive plants in trash bags and put it out in the regular trash. Do not send it to the compost. In Michigan, there is a law which allows invasive plants which were removed as part of a invasive plant removal to actually go in with the trash. The last choice is you can hand cut and bag just the heads and remove them with the trash. I've never done that. People think that will help them quite a bit from it spreading, but my opinion is if the plant has been there for a couple of years already, you've probably got millions of seeds in the ground, and you're going to have to be back watching for resprouts anyway. So the hand bagging and cutting the heads seems like a big project for the what you get out of it. To get started on Phragmites control, make sure you can identify Phragmites, distinguish it from other plants. Of course, most of you know what Phragmites looks like. And it looks to me like my screen might be delayed a little bit, so I'll try to click on these earlier. Usually I show a variety of pictures of other plants that look like Phragmites so that people know there are other things out there. Today we're not going to do that. You can always investigate that yourself. Native versus non-native. Yes, there's a native Phragmites that's been around for thousands of years. And instead of getting into details on how to distinguish that, I suggest you go to YouTube video number 9, Phragmites by Christy Bayer. She does an excellent job on just helping you learn the difference between the two. Most areas in southeast Michigan, native Phragmites has not been seen in a while. Collect information and make a plan as you would with any invasive plant. Figure out your goals, your resources, procedures, what timing. Make yourself a calendar of when you have to do things. Figure out what equipment you'll need to reach all parts of the site, what supplies you'll need in terms of herbicide and gloves and so forth, and monitor your progress. Very important to take pictures before you start, because next year when you've had an impact on that Phragmites, you want to be able to go back and see exactly how much you've accomplished, and it's usually more than you would expect. Some of the equipment that I recommend homeowners can use would be a standard garden sprayer, a backpack sprayer. Oh, by the way, let's go back here. Don't use any metal tank equipment. Stick with plastic equipment. There can be a reaction between metal tanks and the glyphosate that we're going to recommend. You could use an ATV mounted sprayer that's about a 20 gallon with a pump on it, electrically powered, which can hook up to the battery on the ATV. This is a little thing that we jerry-rigged on Harson's Island about 8 years ago, just when we were getting started with some of our public areas. And that's a little 5-horsepower gas-powered motor and a 100-gallon tank. And it looks like maybe it's not shooting very far, but when you look at it from a different angle, you see that we were probably shooting about 60 to 80 feet there. And we got good control. Later in the presentation, you'll see what happened to that pond that we're spraying there. This is a little jerry-rigged thing that someone on Harson's Island did. He has a tractor. He mounted his tank up here, his sprayer at the top. And down here near his steering wheel, he had the control that he could turn the sprayer left and right as he drove through his 15-foot-tall Phragmites to spray them. This is a piece of equipment which, if you have a large Phragmites area and you don't have the equipment to hand cut it, this is available from a company called Great Lakes Phragmitecutter.com. It's called the Marshmaster, and he charges around $250 to $300 an acre to cut Phragmites. Equipment for cutting over water. These are some things that people on Harson's Island have invented to cut over their marsh area. It's basically PVC tubing that they put together to make these pontoons and carry their lawnmowers out over the water. One of the people on the island is cutting below the water line using a sickle bar cutter, which is attached to their boat and on a ratchet here that can swing down so that that sickle bar cutter is a couple of feet below the water line. And then he has, on the right side, you see a picture of a fork there, a big rake that he attaches to the front of the boat so that he rakes out anything that floats, any of the Phragmites stalks, so that they don't float and infest someone else's property. People need to know about the different chemical definitions. The difference between pesticide and herbicide is that pesticide includes any preparation for destroying plants or animals, whereas an herbicide will only affect plants. When you're hiring someone to do Phragmites control, even though you're hiring them to use herbicide, they will probably be called a certified pesticide applicator because they'll be qualified to do both plants and animals. However, they will be using herbicide. And this is something to keep in mind for the people who are always concerned about the effects that these chemicals are having on our pollinators, such as our bee population and butterflies. We are only using herbicide, which is not intended to and generally does not affect animals. Another item that they need to know is the definition of surfactant. That's a chemical agent capable of reducing the surface tension of a liquid in which it is dissolved. And we do usually use a surfactant with any herbicide that we spray on Phragmites. And the last term that's very important for people to understand is AI, which stands for active ingredient in the bottle. So if you go out and buy a bottle of Roundup at the grocery store, at the hardware store, and you look on there, it'll say it has glyphosate in it, and it'll say it's 2% AI, glyphosate. That means 2% of what's in that bottle is the herbicide glyphosate. You can buy super concentrated Roundup, which might be up to 40%, in which case it's a 40% AI and it's 20 times more concentrated than the other standard bottle of Roundup. And people need to understand how to mix those down so they get the proper proportion. Believe it or not, I'm going to speed it up a little bit because we're about halfway done. The chemicals on dry land and above ordinary high water mark, you can actually use a bottle of Roundup. That includes herbicide and surfactant in the same bottle. Check your local state regulations to make sure there's no restriction against it. But in general, if you're above the ordinary high water mark, not using it anywhere around water, you can use Roundup, and it'll work as well as any aquatic mixture that we're going to tell you about. Anywhere near water, you should only use DEQ-approved glyphosate and surfactant. There is another chemical we'll talk about called imazapyr, but I don't recommend it for homeowners. The mix that you'd need to make would be herbicide and surfactant with the water, sometimes a water conditioner, which we'll talk about, and maybe a dye. I don't use dye anymore because over the years I found out it doesn't help me identify that well the areas that I've already sprayed. I can tell more by the gloss off the leaves than I can from the dye itself. Why mix your own chemicals? Aquatic formulas, those that are approved around water, are not available pre-mixed, ready to use out of the bottle. Also, the second reason would be that you can mix your own chemicals comparable to a Roundup product for about one-fifth the cost of buying Roundup. So for a $15 one-gallon Roundup bottle, you can make something, you can make a gallon yourself for about $3. Do homeowners and volunteers in nature centers need to be certified to mix and apply herbicides? The answer is no. You can mix general use herbicides, which these are, and you can apply them yourself if in compliance with the label requirements on the bottle, including the use of personal protection equipment and disposal, and if you're not doing it for commercial purposes and not in the course of your employment. So if you're employed at a nature center, you cannot do it unless you happen to be a certified pesticide applicator. And I recommend you check with your local DEQ or Department of Agriculture to reconfirm this. Aquatic herbicides, they're labeled caution as opposed to warning or danger. They're general use pesticides, not classified as restricted use by the EPA. They're systemic. They're taken into the plant and translocated to the roots. And they're non-selective or broad spectrum, which means that they'll kill other plants that they come in contact with. Any other green plants, you can figure it'll also kill those. If you get a little bit on the bark of a tree nearby, I wouldn't worry about it too much. It probably will not affect the tree. Phragmites herbicides, there's two basic herbicides. One is imazapyr. It can be applied in the fall or summer. It has a little better control rate than glyphosate, but it costs about seven times as much. And the one brand name out there is called Habitat. I don't recommend imazapyr for homeowners. I recommend glyphosate. Imazapyr, I've seen areas that have been sprayed with imazapyr, and I've seen some of those areas, nothing has grown for years afterwards, for 3 years. There's an area right near me on Harson's Island which was sprayed with imazapyr, and it's 3 years ago now, and nothing has grown there yet. Glyphosate can be applied to the Phragmites only in the fall, generally between mid-August and the end of September. There's a variety of brand names out there. There's a list of 10 of them. They're all basically the same product, and they usually come at 53.8% AI in the bottle. So half of what's in the bottle is herbicide, and the other half is usually water. Any of those are basically the same product because all of them are made by the same company and then distributed to these various companies that package it. This is about the toxicity of these Phragmites herbicides. If you look at this chart, the left side is the beginning of the chart, the right side is the end of the chart. You look at glyphosate, and the number in this chart is 5,000 or over 5,000. What that represents is 5,000 milligrams of glyphosate per kilogram of an organism which might ingest that mix. We'll have the result of a oral lethal dose, 50, which means that they expect that if you took organisms and you gave them 5,000 milligrams per kilogram of weight of the organism, that half of those organisms would die. And so the smaller this number in the chart, the more hazardous or more toxic the chemical is. As you go up the chart, as I'm looking up the chart above the glyphosate, you see vinegar is more hazardous, table salt is more toxic, vitamin C, and then go over to the left side of the chart, we see acetaminophen, which is basically aspirin, come up a ways, cinnamon, aspirin, bleach, caffeine, and nicotine. So nicotine appears to be about 100 times more lethal than glyphosate itself. Surfactants, we talked briefly about them enhancing the spreading, sticking, and wetting properties of the herbicide. It also breaks down the waxy coating on plants. I use Signet Plus. The water is important. It carries the herbicide into the plant cells. Over 98% of your mix will be water. Glyphosate, the herbicide, is a mild acid, and in water it can split into various pieces and connect those pieces to larger molecules. If the water has organics in it, it will tend to split more easily. And so a hard or dirty water can split glyphosate, and it's not recommended to be used when you're making your mix. Desirable water qualities are clean, clear, and free of organic materials, low mineral content, soft water is best. Slightly acidic would be ideal. In most cases, you can use regular tap water. That would be just fine. You might use a water conditioner if you do have water which is not is not good for in terms of the pH. It lowers the pH. Don't use it if you're treating under a DEQ permit. They're usually not allowed. And I use a product called Aqua Buff Liquid Water Conditioner, about a half an ounce per gallon of water. Preferred water would be distilled water, soft water, municipal water, clean, clear lake water, and clean, clear rain water. Do not use well water or pond water if possible. There'd be too many organics in it. How much glyphosate do you put on an acre of Phragmites? The maximum amount allowed per treatment under both most state permits and on the bottle of glyphosate is 6 pints per acre. The Signet Plus, which is shown there, is the surfactant. That's limited to 1 pint per acre, and water conditioner is not specified. So the bottom paragraph there, low volume sprayer mix recommendations. That is if you're mixing anywhere from, let's say, 1 to 100 gallons, this is the recommendation from a document called A Guide to the Control and Management of Invasive Phragmites, which is produced by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the Michigan DEQ, and the Michigan DNR. They recommend a 1 to 1.5% solution of a 53.8% AI glyphosate product, which is those 10 different name brands I mentioned. That would be comparable to putting about 2 ounces of glyphosate in 1 gallon of water. That gives you actually results in a 1 to 1.5% solution of the 50% product. Therefore, it ends up mixing it down that your mix will be about a 0.84% AI. You can use a state approved non-ionic surfactant at a rate recommended on the label, such as that Signet Plus. And there's no mention in that book about using any kind of water conditioner. If you're going to mix 1 gallon for a low-volume sprayer mix, you start with about 3/4 of the water. You can add water conditioner if you're going to use it. You add your herbicide in bold there, 2 ounces in that mix. Add your surfactant. Top it off with water to bring the whole thing up to 128 ounces. Add dye if you want it in there. And that'll give you a 1 gallon of the mix. And if you look back at 6 pints per acre of the glyphosate, that would be comparable to spraying this 1 gallon in a 900 square foot area, or about 30 feet by 30 feet. Now, my second biggest mistake in 10 years of Phragmites control was not applying multiple treatments in the first year. Retreatment, the maximum herbicide quantities to be used that are given on the label say they are per treatment. So that 6 pints per acre is per treatment. And DEQ permits, particularly in Michigan, state that there should be a minimum of 24 hours between treatments. Therefore, you are allowed to retreat, if you haven't already retweeted, the Phragmites. I've obtained the best results by mixing my herbicide at actually a lower AI rate than recommended in that document I mentioned, and then retreating it at 2-week intervals, but only retreating any remaining green Phragmites. By not retreating it in the first year, the surviving Phragmites will grow. It's like not taking all of your antibiotic prescriptions. The strong ones are going to survive to reproduce the next year. These are some examples of areas areas that I treated and then went back, you can see that there are green Phragmites still in there. So I would just treat those green ones on the second go-round. Here's an area. It looks like maybe only 40% of them were affected. So I've got a decent amount to retreat in that area. Here's a little bit in the middle that needs to be retreated. And here's just a few sprigs up front. So if you go back after 2 weeks, if you can spray in mid-August, go back the 1st of September, and if you see a situation like this, retreat those green Phragmites. Then wait 2 weeks, go back in mid-September, and if there's any that are still green, treat them again. I call this the wipeout program. It's short-term. It is labor-intensive because you're retreating, but it is maximum control. This is one reason that this is not usually used in large-scale projects, because it is labor-intensive to be returning to an area when you could be out. You've got acres and acres more that you've not even started treating. You can spend your time on that. So the program is, prior to June, pre-cut it. August 15th, treat it. Go back September 1st, 15th, and 30th, and retreat any green Phragmites at that time. And October 15th, you can cut it after it's had 2 weeks at least for the chemical to get into the root system, and you've done most of your work in about a four-month period. Now, if you're going to mix 1 gallon under the wipeout program, the only difference on this page is that I'm only putting 1 ounce of glyphosate in a gallon. Now, the recommendation in the book was 2 ounces, but interestingly enough, when you look on the label of glyphosate, it says to use 1 ounce per gallon in low-volume sprayer mixes. So I'm actually matching the requirement on the label and thinking that retreating is going to put a lot of chemicals into the environment. If you mix it at this lower rate, you'll probably end up having fewer chemicals in the environment after doing even your 2 or 3 retreats of the few stalks that are left than you would have if you used 2 ounces the first time around. So if you're using this rate, the 1 ounce per gallon, you can figure on spraying up to 450 square feet, about a 21 by 20 foot, 21 foot area with 1 gallon of that mix. Now, if you're going to do other types of treatments, such as glove of death, you probably want to increase the ratio. Instead of using a 0.85 AI, you probably want to get up to 2.5% to 5% AI, which would be about 6 to 12 ounces of glyphosate per gallon of water. If you're going to use a wipe it, you would use the same. And if you're going to use cut and dab or injection, you might go up to 15 or 25% AI, because on each stalk you'll be putting very little bit of chemical. You won't have much room on that stalk to get chemical. So in that case, I'd recommend you mix about 4.5 to 7.5 ounces per pint. You probably aren't going to need more than a pint anyways for what you're doing. Usually I provide for homeowners a list of chemical availability and costs, how much it costs for each product. In this case, I show that a 2.5 gallon container of herbicide is about $100 on the internet. You can buy SureClear in a quart bottle, but that's $50, which actually you're paying much more per unit of measurement if you buy the small quantity. Let's see, 1 gallon of SureClear Plus, which is glyphosate plus surfactant. If you want to avoid that part of the mixing, it comes in an 18% AI product. Therefore, if you're going to mix it down to about 1%, you'd have about 18 parts water to 1 part of your SureClear Plus. And a gallon of that product costs about $60. The minimum purchase option would be to buy SureClear Plus and mix it up. You'd be able to treat about a third of an acre for about $80. A larger, more economical purchase option would be to buy a 2.5 gallon of glyphosate, buy some surfactant. Even if you wanted to buy the water conditioner and the dye, the whole thing would cost about $250, and it would be enough to spray about 3 acres. And you still have plenty of Aqua Buff and Signet Plus left over. Signet Select, I mean. it would cost you about $75 per acre for treatment in that case, and if you left out the dye and water conditioner, it would only be about $50 an acre. And you can save your unused products for up to 5 years. So if you don't need to spray 3 acres, save it. Don't let it freeze. Don't leave it in the garage over the winter unless you have a heated garage. Otherwise, it will probably not be as effective the next year. These are some of the products that I use. I buy mine from Signet Enterprises in Flint, Michigan. There's their phone number. They'll package it up and ship it to you, and you'll get it by UPS in about 3 days. When to treat? In southeast Michigan region, mid-August and end of September, not after the first killing frost, because it will no longer translocate those chemicals to the roots, not within 4 weeks of the last cutting or burning. Before treatment day, you'll want to check the weather forecast, post signs. If you're spraying around water, you'll have to close the potable water intakes. Review your plan, reread your chemical labels. On treatment day, make sure it's not too windy, that you're not expecting rain within 6 hours. A sunny day will help it absorb better. Spray the leaves and stems to full coverage without dripping off. If possible, learn to spray while you're walking backwards. Try to use as much of the mix on the same day or soon after as you can. The longer it sits after you've mixed it, it may lose some efficiency. Record keeping, here's an idea of the kind of records you could keep so that next year, if one area is not as well controlled as another, you might go back and find out what you did differently. After the treatment day, don't go back in that water to swim within 24 hours. You can open the water intakes. Be patient and don't expect plant discoloration for about 2 weeks. That's why we leave 2 weeks between treatments. We want to make sure we give it plenty of time. If you go back after 2 weeks and it's still green, give it a few more days before you respray it. Don't cut or burn within 2 weeks. Herbicide safety. Follow the instructions on the label. Use proper procedure. Use recommended safety equipment. The safety equipment recommended on the label is called personal protection equipment, and it's recommended for persons who are using the diluted mix solution. So if you're going to do the mixing yourself, you may need more than this. This is the personal protection equipment, basically dedicated clothing, long sleeves, long pants, closed shoes, socks, gloves, and a hat. If you're going to be mixing it yourself, you should include some nitrile gloves, nitrile apron, and a goggles or a face shield. And this is just some photos of some of the products, some of the items that I keep handy. The respirator, I don't really use anymore. If I'm out spraying and I can smell the product, I just don't spray. I've got the wind going in the wrong direction. You probably need some measuring cups and funnels. You'll need a place to store the products, some secondary containment buckets, some measuring bottles, spill containment pan, which is basically a masonry mixing pan that you get at the lumber yard. Here's some abbreviated safety procedures. I recommend that you print the handout, read through these, and of course read anything that's on the label of the products that you buy. Here's additional pesticide safety tips, and we will not go through all of these, but please read them before you do any work. Permits to remove, burn, cut, and herbicide Phragmites. There's no such thing as a permit to remove it or to dig it or till it out. It doesn't do anything but spread them. There's no such thing as a permit for that. For burning, you should get a permit from your local fire department, and if you're going to burn it, I recommend a prescribed burn contractor that you use rather than do it yourself. Permits to cut Phragmites. Many states, the DEQ has a permit requirement if you're cutting between the ordinary high water mark and the water's edge, and anything, of course, in standing water, you would need a permit. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency has permits required for herbiciding. In general, your state agency, state DEQ, will issue those permits, even though it's a federal permit. And it's not usually required unless you're spraying like 20 miles toward the shoreline or 1,000 acres of property. Permit the herbicide from the state. It may not be required if you're above the ordinary high water mark or in a small pond without an outlet. The Ontario area has a restriction on the use of herbicides anywhere around water, and I heard today from some of the people in the room here, they may actually have other restrictions in Ontario where you can't even use it above the ordinary high water mark. If you're going to hire a contractor, make sure they have the licenses they need, a business license, aquatic pest management certification, and a right-of-way certification. And your local Department of Agriculture or your state Department of Agriculture will have a list of approved contractors. This is about our local Clay Township Management Program. I'm going to skip through this in an effort to get us to the end of this presentation. And this is some of the results of what we've had success with. Here's someone who had a problem with a place to tie up their boat before and after. Here's a little boathouse which had fire safety restrictions or concerns because of the Phragmites, and this is after. Those are just some cattails that have regrown down below there. This is that parking lot in Berkeley, and as you can see from the lower left picture, in the fall of 2013, it was nice and brown after I treated it, and in the fall of 2014, there were absolutely no resprouts, and I think the reason why this was so successful was I did do the second treatment of the stuff that was still green, and also I think the plant was stressed in the first place from trying to grow through the cracks in the pavement. This was an ecosystem restoration that we did on Harshness Island. This picture was after the first winter when we cut and got rid of the old material and before the first treatment, so this was probably in August. This was after we had treated it. In the winter, we cut down the Phragmites and got rid of it. The following year, because the pond was back down to about 8 inches of water at depth instead of 3 feet of water from decades of Phragmites buildup, they dredged it. And 2 years later, we had nice native plants coming up around the outside of that pond. Nothing was planted. Long-range planting, treat the outliers first, work with your neighbors, photograph your progress, and please be patient. Work with your neighborhood association, local nature club, offer to show others with workshops and literature how to control Phragmites, and you'll have a much greater impact on our invasive Phragmites world. Here's a couple of resources for you to know about. Phragmites.org is my website. I have a newsletter. If you send me a note or that says subscribe to newsletter at phragmites.org, I'll put you on the list for the free newsletter, which comes out about once a month. And that last document at the bottom is the one I referred to, which is a very good document available online, free. We'll skip through these, and we're into Q&A with 7 minutes left.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Well, we do have a number of questions that have come in, and if you have questions now and you're listening, go ahead and enter them into your chat panel or your Q&A panel, and we'll try our best to get to them. Here's one talking about or asking about cutting and herbiciding. Managers used to think that spread via roots and rhizomes was the primary means of Phragmites spread, but we now also know that the seeds are viable. Cutting the seed heads in the summer before spraying with herbicide is something that managers are now more interested in. So can you talk a little bit about whether cutting the seed head is an effective and an efficient approach prior to a later summer herbicide, or is it just as effective to wait until the fall to treat the plant with herbicide?
In terms of the seed heads, I recommend that if the Phragmites stand has been there for 2 or 3 years already, I wouldn't bother removing the seed heads. There's millions of seeds already in the ground, and a few more aren't going to make any difference. If it's a brand new stand, it might be a very good system to try to get rid of those heads before they fall on the ground.
Okay. I'm just also thinking that a lot of times landowners want to be active during the summer months, and I believe you also mentioned that sometimes applying maybe it's not just cutting the seed head, but also mowing the plant during the summer or cutting the plant during the summer?
Yes, I don't recommend mowing it after the beginning of June, though. The areas that I experimented with, I cut some in the beginning of June. I cut some in July, and both of them, particularly the July one, the stalks were so sparse in between and not very tall, that when I went to spray, I was getting too much of the herbicide on the ground from the spaces between the plants. So now I recommend do it before the 1st of June, if at all possible.
Great. Here's a question asking, we have newly emerging Phragmites in our area. Someone told us that it could be the native variety. How do we know if it's invasive, and if it's native, should we still manage it?
No, if it's native, you don't even want to manage it to encourage it. But if it's if you want to know the difference between the two, I recommend that YouTube video, video number 9, Phragmites by Christy Beyer, I think it is.
Okay, thank you. And we'll make sure that that link is up on our website. And I will also note that it used to be thought that the native Phragmites species was not very commonly occurring, but we are finding more and more instances of it throughout the Great Lakes region and throughout Michigan in particular. So that's always something to be on the lookout for. Is it too late to mow Phragmites for herbicide treatment this year? Did you just answer
that?
That's
a good question. No, if you get out there very soon, I'm talking the next week or so, and get it cut, you'll still have enough regrowth above the ground to spray. You might have to wait until, you might want to wait until the beginning of September to do your first spray, though, or maybe even a little bit into September to give it more time to grow. If you cut it right now, it'll probably be 3 to 4 feet tall come August.
Kind of a two-part question. Do you have recommendations for mowers that have blades that can run under the water line? And if you don't have water control, what are the best ways to control frag without herbicide?
The first question, the blades. The kind of blades like a lawnmower, which spins in a circle. I don't know of any equipment that works like that and cuts it below the water line. The only cutting below the waterline that I've seen done is with the sickle bar cutter, which is the two blades that crisscross each other. And there are hand, almost like a lawn trimmer that has those that you can buy for about $400 at most landscape places that have a sickle bar cutter that's about 2 feet long, and you can use that. And people have used those to cut below the waterline too. The second question was?
If you don't want to use herbicide and you also don't have water control.
If you don't have water control and you don't want to use herbicide, you could pray.
I think Janice Gilbert gave a presentation. She lives in Ontario, and she gave a presentation or a webinar about a year ago and said very much the same thing.
Cut it a lot. That'll reduce it. You could probably get it to reduce back to about 20% of its strength if you repeatedly cut it every week for a couple of years.
Okay. Another question that gets into, I guess, landowner objectives. How do you talk to landowners about what conditions they want after Phragmites removal? And is anything better than Phragmites, or are specific conditions or habitat types being targeted?
Well, it's hard to talk to most homeowners about habitat. That's not usually their interest. And so I do mention it as a goal, but I don't focus on it with homeowners because they are more interested in the view and fire safety and other things like that. And there was another question you had?
Is anything better than Phragmites, or...?
Anything is better than Phragmites, yes.
If we control Phragmites on our property, how much of a problem will the Phragmites be that's within 100 yards of our property? And so if we're trying to control frag on our property but our neighbors aren't, are we just wasting our time?
You're not wasting your time, because there's a very good chance your neighbors will see what you've done. And within a few years, they'll come to you and find out what you've been doing, because that's what we've had in our program in Clay Township. We get many people who come with that question, and within a year, they're back with their neighbor who wants to learn in our workshops how to do it.
You had a slide of a restoration site, and the question is, how did you get rid of the mowed Phragmites at the restoration site?
If it was the pond, which I showed at the end, that we raked it all to the middle of the pond and we burned it.
And a question about cost. I know that you did talk about costs throughout your presentation. When you're talking to landowners, what do you advise them on sort of the cost per acre for Phragmites treatment, and how many years will they be expected to have those sorts of costs?
Okay. Generally, the cost in a large-scale project under grants, usually they're talking about $1,000 an acre. Homeowners, I think about $300 an acre, they can control their Phragmites.
And for how long? Is it that cost for several years?
That will do it for quite a while. Yep, for let's say 5 years. And then after that, the cost will be minimal because they'll just be treating individual stalks.
Great. Are there any other questions from the room? Well, that's all I have for questions coming in, so I do want to thank you, Bob, and ask you if you have any final thoughts before we sign off.
I do. I'd like to leave all of our Phragmites fighters out there with a blessing. It goes like this. Let us pray. May the sun shine upon you, the winds be at your back, the earth remain firm beneath your feet, the waters not rise above the top of your boots, and if the Phragmites claims your vehicle, may you have great comprehensive and a low deductible.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you very much for your presentation today, and thanks for all of the attendees. This webinar was recorded, and we will post that to our website within the next few days. If you have any questions, you can contact us at the Great Lakes Commission, or we'll provide you with Bob's contact, and you can communicate with him directly. So thank you, everyone, for your time, and have a great day.